Let's first go to Leviticus, or why you cry, the 23rd chapter. And I'm starting with verse 4. It says, these are the feasts of Yahuwah, even a holy convocation, which you shall proclaim in their season. In the 14th day of the first month at evening is Yahuwah's Passover. And on the 15th day of the same month is the feast of unleavened bread unto Yahuwah. 7 days ye must eat unleavened bread. In the first day shall ye have an holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein. So in short, I'm going to tell you, the answer to that question is, it's commanded. This feast is first important because it's commanded, okay? We got to get out of the whys, and the why is simply the Father said so. He said his Torah is for our good always, so he gives us a commanded feast. In Torah, the word for feast is moed, or moedim, which means moedim is plural for moed, which is appointed times. Okay, it's an appointed time, appointed meeting, appointed places. Father has everything that he appoints. And so when he appoints a time, we should observe it. When he appoints a dinner or a feast, we should observe it. When he tells us what to eat, we should eat which he appoints us to eat. All right, so I'm going to move on to Shemot chapter 12, which is Exodus, excuse me, chapter 12. And I'm starting with verse 7. I'm going hard copy, Moreh, Lamar. Don't forget me. I'm hard copy today. You see it? All right. So I'm going to Shemot chapter 12. It says, that's still the wrong Shemot. I'm back in Leviticus. Y'all excuse me. Bear with me. Yeah, now I see why you go digital. I'm about to switch to digital. All right. Shemot chapter 12, verse 7. It says, and they shall take the blood of and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper doorposts of the houses wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread and with bitter herbs, they shall eat it. So it is commanded that there's a certain meal that is on Pesach that you should eat. And Moreh Lamar just went into it about the Pesach and what Pesach is. Pesach is not only the day. Pesach is more so the remembrance of the Pesach itself, which was the sacrifice, the Zabat, which was Mashiach for us who believe in Mashiach. Because there's some out here who don't believe in the Mashiach. But the Mashiach is the lamb that's without spot or blemish. But what's written in Torah, as Moreh said, the beginning, we're trying to move forward from the beginning to the end. And this is pointing to something. So the Torah's instructions, which are pointing to something. And so here it said that we should eat the Pesach. So the Pesach, during that time, verbatim, was actually a lamb without spot or blemish. Do not let these people that's come with this modern doctrine think that we're cannibals, because you will hear that doctrine saying, when you say you're supposed to eat the body of Mashiach, you're cannibals, and that's nowhere in scripture. We understand that literally here, this was actually talking about a literal lamb that is in the dietary law, all right? So we were to actually eat literally a lamb, but that lamb was the Pesach or the Passover. So that is a part of the meal that we would have. So what is the importance of it? It is important because this meal is pointing to an even bigger meal, and that's what we want, is the bigger meal, okay? So it's my goal today to try to show you that. Well, I'm going to share something with you real quick. When I first started keeping these feasts, just being honest, I didn't really enjoy them. But I did them because the Father said so. So the answer to my why was it's commanded, but I didn't understand why I had to give up bread for 7 days. When I eat one piece of chicken, I need two pieces of bread, all right? So this was kind of like a burden to me when I first started keeping it. But it was commanded, so I kept it because it was commanded. So what's the importance of the meal again? The Father said so. However, it's really important when we actually start seeing, as Moreh Lamar you brought out, what's written in the physical is written to show us something that's going to be very spiritual. And we're going to try to get to the spiritual in just a moment as we're going through this. But I want to point out that we're supposed to eat it with bitter herbs, and we're also supposed to eat it with unleavened bread, or matzah, as Moreh went into. So when we have this meal, it's very important that we do not have any leavened bread, but we have unleavened bread, and we also have bitter herbs. When you eat the bitter herb, it is something that will make you tear up sometimes if you have that right bitter herb. People got that strong bitter herb, it will make you tear up that horseradish root, and it will make you tear up, and it will make you remember the burden and the bondage of Mitzrayim and the tears that our people went through and that pain and suffering. But the lamb is the important part that we want to focus on without spot or blemish, because when you get to the brick kind of shot, it says Mashiach was what? Without spot or blemish. So these feasts started getting enjoyable to me when I understood the importance of the feast itself and the meal itself. Because the importance is Pesach, first of all, represents salvation.
Because if you put the blood on the doorpost, I'm gonna get back on track, all right, don't get me for this. If you put the blood on the doorpost, I got to tell the importance of the meal. So if you put the blood on the doorpost, then everyone's firstborn that was in that house was what? Delivered. But anyone who did not have blood on the doorpost, they house in that house, what happened? The firstborn died. So we can first see that this Passover now is about what? Salvation. Then we have unleavened bread, which is another part that we're supposed to eat with this meal, which represents sanctification. And Moreh touched on it shortly, because we're not supposed to go this far. The first fruits is going to be like a resurrection, or the first that's going to be risen with Mashiach. And that's who we are in this room today. We're some first fruit, because there's not many people that's really walking this walk. A lot of people want to do Easter, which you cannot find anywhere in the scriptures. There's no commandments on how to keep that. A lot of people want to do Christmas, when there's no commandment on how to do those things, but because they do not see the importance of these feasts. Now can I go, my brother?
Oh, yeah.
Let me get my tablet out, y'all bear with me.
Go digital, Moreh.
Go digital? All right, let me go digital a little while.
You know your time.
Ain't nothing much space up here. See, I'm focused at the Moreh did, but a little bit different, because I want y'all to focus on time, as we have to focus on time. Because I want to drop to Shemot, Exodus chapter 12, verse 19. It says, 7 days there shall be no leaven found in your houses. For whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. Ye shall eat nothing leavened in all your habitations. Ye shall eat unleavened bread. When I first started keeping this feast, I made some mistakes. I seen that you shall not eat unleavened bread. So I took all my leaven out of the house. But there's another part of this verse that's very important. But it's something you shall do. Okay? And we're going to try to bring this out spiritually when I get to it. The shall is you shall eat unleavened bread. So when I first started this feast, the only time I ate unleavened bread was when I was at the feast. I didn't know how to prepare it. I didn't know where to get it from. And as some of you that are here today, it was my first time. So when I was at the feast, I heard about it, and I said, oh, I'm not supposed to eat any bread. I went home, I threw all my bread out, but I did not purchase or make any unleavened bread, which is very important, but that is a part of the command. You must eat unleavened bread. Now, here's why all this is so important. It is important because our Father is a covenant Elohim. He's a covenant Elohim. And a covenant is an agreement between two parties. He said, I will bless you if you keep my commands, and I will curse you if you what? If you break my commands. And some people say, well, what you eat don't matter. If you eat some leavened bread during the feast of Pesach and unleavened bread, what did the Father say? You'll be cut off. See, we got to start studying to show ourselves approved. It's very important because these are the covenant Elohim. This begins our new year. This is the first feast of the feast season, and it is very important that we know what we're supposed to eat on this time and know what it represents. All right? So this is why it's important, because he is a covenant Elohim, and these feasts are about covenant. It's about renewing your covenant with the Father. Each year you start over. As Moreh Lamont said, there's things we shouldn't bring in here from year to year, but guess what? No, don't guess what. Know what? We still bring some of that mess in, but the Father gives us each year time to do what? Try to renew. So this is the beginning of the year, and we're commanded to do this feast, and it is a covenant. So that's why it's so important, because it's a two-way agreement between two parties. Now I'm about to go digital on y'all. Let's go digital. I want to go to 1 Corinthians, if you would. I'm starting at chapter 11, and I'm going to verse 23. But before I go, let me get one more thing so I can tie it all together. Because I told y'all about time. Verse 34 of Exodus, it says, and the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneaded throes being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. So basically what I want to do is focus on time. You read that chapter, it's going to tell you that Pharaoh and the rest of the Egyptians wanted Israel out of their house in haste, quickly. They basically kicked Israel out after what happened on Pesach. So when he says, eat it with your loins girt and your shoes on your feet, that means you had to be ready to go. As Moreh was saying earlier, we got to start being ready to go. We have to be ready when? Ready right now. Shoes on your feet, eating what the Father said, eat. So now, when we're focusing on time, what I want you to look at is, it's not about just the bread itself. It's about they did not have time to wait. And what do people do today before they start serving the Father? I see y'all real disciplined, and I would like to be in there as long as y'all. Y'all can be in there from 12:30 to like 9 o'clock. I say, how y'all can be in there all day? One day I'm going to get there, but just not right now. That's how most people walk, right? But when he told them in haste, you got to be ready when? You got to be ready now. So the leavened bread, in order for you to have leavened bread, there's going to be something that will actually happen naturally. There's yeast, the things that will be in the air that will get into the bread. They will leave it out. They will have it on their kneading throws, and in a certain way you prepare it. And the longer you let it sit, the more it will what? It will rise. Okay? So understand, this is about something being puffed up. And we know that there's a lot of people in here, not necessarily in here, but there's a lot of people in the world that's what? Puffed up. So now start looking at the importance of this meal and this bread. So if you're puffed up because you're waiting to serve the Father, you will never serve him. Moreh just brought it out. You have to do something. Everyone said they're waiting on the Father, but the Father gave us commandments and said, do something now. Do something quickly. Hurry up. So again, the importance of this meal is it's time sensitive that we get this thing right. It is very important because when you let the leaven and it rises, Moreh told you about the sweet bread. When it goes through the fermentation process, do you know what actually happens in the fermentation process? What happens is the yeast goes in and eats away all the sweetness and the bread starts to sour. So if we continually waiting and not purging, we sourdough. We're sourdough. So we have to understand this process. Now let me go into another quick, well, I'll go into that later. Y'all be with me. I get so excited when I'm talking about the Father. So we're sourdough, but it's a fermentation process that happens. And I want to touch on this real quick, because I didn't know all this stuff, and I had to start researching and wanted to know what's the importance of it. So I'm going to read you the definition of ferment. It says, also called organized ferment, any group of living organisms such as yeast, mold, or bacteria that causes fermentation. Fermentation is a metabolic process that converts sugar to acids, gases, and or alcohol. It occurs in yeast and bacteria, but also in oxygen-starved muscle cells, as in the case of lactic acid. So, fermentation, when it's happening, oxygen is starting to be what? Taken away. Hebrews, Bible readers, you got a Bible. If I'm talking about oxygen and oxygen being taken away, that's like you being strangled and can't breathe. What does that bring to mind, any of you? Huh? I heard it. Death, right? So if you can't breathe, you go what? You're going to die. Genesis, a bare sheep. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth and seen all that in them is. On the sixth day, he created man, and he did what to man? He did what? He breathed into the man what? Breath of life. So when we focus on the Ruach, you look that up, Ruach is going to be what? Spirit. Breath or air. And so if we're full of leaven and we're being oxygen deprived, what does the Ruach represent to us? Oxygen. That is our spiritual oxygen. So what's the importance of this meal? If we have a bunch of leaven in the house when the Father's telling us to get all the leaven out of the house and we want to hold on to old ways, we are oxygen deprived, oxygen starved, and we are dying slow because we're not moving fast and purging all leaven out of the house. And as Moreh brought out, you can find leaven in all types of places. And I'm not making a mockery of what he said. I'm making a mockery of my own self. When I used to purge out leaven, y'all know how the door of the microwave closed and the little latch thing? Well, there's little holes there. From warming up food in the microwave, sometimes there are little crumbs and stuff left in those cracks. We used to go so crazy that we was trying to do what?
Clean out the cracks.
We're trying to clean out the cracks. But as Moreh brought out, what does the Father really want us to see? Our hearts, and there's always something left, and we should always, as he said, day for day be what? Constantly purging so that you understand the importance of this feast and what we need to be doing. And yes, we need to get all the leaven out. I would never go against Torah. But understand this. Do not be focusing so much on trying to go up under the couch, go into the kids' room, because they might have snuck a cookie, and you're hunting that down, but you ain't opening up that heart trying to sleep. I'm still prideful. I'm still hateful. I'm still unforgiving.
Right.
I want to be back with my brothers and sisters because I love them, but I ain't going to humble myself.
Yeah.
Right. Are we looking for any of that? There's a whole lot of divisions and splits among our people because people will not what? Purge or humble themselves. So we can judge everyone on the leaven that we find our cookie crumb that we may find, but I'm still looking at you walking around here prideful, non-forgiving, not willing to forgive anyone, and the fact is right there in your face, the person is even reaching out saying, I'm sorry. I didn't know as Moreh brought out. That's why you're acting like that, and you still refuse to forgive, but you got all the leaven out your house, right? Okay, let's move on. So I want to go into this so we understand that a little leaven leavens the whole lump, and Moreh already touched on that. What does that mean? Bread has to sit for a certain amount of time before it rises, all right? So now, if you want a loaf to rise quick without having to wait, you take a piece of the old loaf, and if you put a piece of the bread from the old loaf into a new loaf, what would a new loaf do? It would rise. Why? Because you put some leavened dough in unleavened dough, therefore you now have what? Leavened bread. We're supposed to have unleavened bread. So when it's saying a little leaven leavens the whole lump, our Father, the way he got this word set up, it is beautiful. Because he puts everything in a physical that we can see spiritually what we're supposed to be doing and the importance of it. So the importance of this feast is that we are to actually come out from any false ways, purge ourselves in the sanctification process and unleaven ourselves and make sure that we eat matzah. I want to focus on this now. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and 23. It says, for I have received of the master, or sovereign, that which also I delivered unto you, that the master Yahushua, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the cup of the new covenant of the Brit Kadashah in my blood. This do you as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. So again, what is the importance of this feast? Who is the Pesach? Who is the Pesach? Yahushua Mashiach. So it says, as oft as you think of me, you should, I get it later. As oft as you think of me, or you do this as oft as you what? You remember me. What should we be remembering him? Each year at the time of what? At the time of Pesach. Because he was the what? The Pesach. He was he without spot or blemish. And as Moreh was saying, a little leaven leavens a whole lump, and we're supposed to be purging. There are many, and I'm not trying to make mockery of any as they're trying to make of us. However, there are those who do not believe. That little bit of leaven is leavening a whole lot of lumps around here who do not believe in Mashiach.
Right.
Okay? So if anyone is trying to plant that leaven in you, run. Gird up your loins. Run. All right? Because that is leaven. It's leavening a whole lump. They're putting that stuff in and that false doctrine and having people deny Mashiach. And Mashiach is saying as often as we think of him, we should remember him, we should do what? Have this feast. So this is very important. But he says some other things too. So the importance is it's a covenant. The importance is what does each part represent. And now there's also a conduct. It's a very important conduct you must have when eating this meal. It says in verse 26, for as after you eat, oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the master's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the master or the sovereign unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the sovereign. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the sovereign's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. So, it says, you shall not eat unworthily. The Father gives us what we're to eat, when we're to eat at appointed times with an appointed diet, and he also gives us what? Appointed conduct to even partake of the meal. And if you eat of it unworthily, what does that mean to anyone? What does eating of something unworthily mean to you? Somebody help me out. So take it for granted. Okay, take it for granted. Okay, I heard something else.
Transgress against.
Okay, amen.
Transgress against the feast.
Transgressing against the feast. Okay. Not prepared for it, okay? Some people is not honest, they're not what? Prepared for it, and they're transgressing it even when they what? Are keeping it. How do you prepare for it? 7 days you must eat what? Unleavened bread, but before you can start eating unleavened bread, you must first do what to your house? You must purge it or cleanse your house. There are people that show up to the feast and ain't done a bit of purging all year. There are people that don't keep Shabbat, but they want to come to the feast. The Father even says those with uncircumcised hearts shall not come into his house. And we will not purge, and circumcision of the womb means to cut away something. So that's a form of purging also. So if people are not preparing their heart to serve the Father, they're coming unworthy. To some it's a fashion show. To some they want to come to cause what? Division and confusion. They're eating of it unworthily, and for some they're doing it because I don't want you to know that I'm not truly a real believer. I just like this good food y'all be having. I mean, this is a really nice place. This AC blowing cool now to help me out. Got a lot of good looking people here with y'all nice white garments on, cups full of tea, and I know about that fish and chicken and all that stuff that's in the back. That's why I'm here. Let's be honest. We have those, right? But the point is, you cannot eat of it unworthily. So if I have aught with my brother still in my heart, and I have not went and made it right with my brother, am I really worthy to be at the feast? Partaking of the meal? If I have aught with my sister, same difference. If I haven't been honoring my mother and father, if I have been willingly breaking Shabbat just because I don't want to do it, but I'm showing up here because that's what people from D.C. or Virginia and Wilmington and North Carolina and Georgia, all of them going to be there, so it's going to be a lot of people there, so I want to be there, kind of like how we went to concerts back in the day. Oh, everybody going to be there. That's why some people come to the feast, and that is still being unworthily. They're not honoring it as the brother brought out, and they're transgressing it as my sister brought out. So we must make sure we have the proper conduct, and this word says, for this very reason, that's the reason why there's some of us weak, that are sickly. That's why there's some of us that's what? Sleep. We keep playing around with the Father's feast days and playing around with his word and his Torah, we might end up sleep. I'm going to drop that. Moreh the mind, you already covered it, but I just want to go to 1 Corinthians 1 more time, chapter 5. And I'm starting with verse 7. It says, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Mashiach, our Pesach, or Passover, is unleavened for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So again, it's telling us we got to purge out all the old. Not saying that there is, but it's a serious time now because we're going to be getting into the feast. And it's very important that if we have anything in our hearts that we need to get out, while we have intermission, while we have break, I would hope that you try to get it out. Right. Pray to the Father, take your little moment, get it out. If there's someone here that you ain't quite seeing eye to eye with, well, I'm going to shalom, but I don't mean them shalom. The Father knows your heart. You know, we can say shalom or hug, but I ain't really want to hug you. That's still old left. Because I should want to hug you. Yep. I didn't drive all the way to Georgia, which is 6+ hours for me, and I got on the road at 11 last night. Finally, Moreh was out about it. I was supposed to be out there since 10 o'clock yesterday morning, but I finally got on the road, sleepy as can be, praise the Father. But I didn't come because I didn't want to hug my brothers and my sisters. I came in first because I love the Father and because I what? I love my brothers and sisters. And that's what we should be, because we should not have a feast with old leaven. Now, let me show something that we got to start getting to. So I said, purge out the old leaven. It said, therefore, let us keep the feast not with old leaven, neither with leaven of malice, wickedness, but with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I wrote unto you an epistle not to company with fornicators, yet not altogether with fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or idolaters, for then must ye needs to go out of the world. But now I've written unto you not to keep company if any man that is called a brother be a fornicator, covetous, idolater, or railer, a drunkard, an extortioner, with such know not to eat. We want to invite everybody to the feast sometimes. And we know they ain't a whole bunch of mess. What's the importance of this meal? What's the conduct of this meal? If there's someone that is being any of these in the scripture, it said we should not even what? We should not even eat with him. It said, deliver such a one up to Hashatan that he may kill the flesh that the Father may save his what?
Soul.
That the Father may save his soul. This is something else we got to learn to do also. This is a Moreh. This is a set-apart feast day, and it has set-apart rules, regulations, or it has set-apart ordinances. And the ordinance is your heart should be circumcised, you must be purging and cleansing, and you must be trying to change, and you must be trying to do it when?
Now.
Right now. You're supposed to be doing it yesterday, you're supposed to be doing it this moment, and the moment after this moment, and continually, we should be purging as that stuff is being revealed in us. We're supposed to be trying to do what? Purge it out of us. All right? Now, I'm about to shift gears. Everybody pretty clear with the importance of the meal? How much time I got? I got a few more minutes left.
Yeah.
All right. I want to go to Yehuchanan or John chapter 6. Because remember I said that at one point I forgot, or I didn't forget, I didn't know till I was supposed to eat unleavened bread for the 7 days, or I didn't have it, so I didn't take it as serious because I didn't really understand it. Therefore, I didn't have the unleavened bread, but I wouldn't eat unleavened bread. But I want to focus on some bread right now. We're going to John, Yehuchanan chapter 6, verse 47. And it reads, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Whose words are these, anyone? These are Mashiach's words, right?
Yes.
And for 7 days, ye must what? And our Mashiach was unleavened for us. He was pure. He didn't have any additives. So it says, I am that bread. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. So we see the Mashiach says what? He who eats this bread shall have what?
Life
forever. But he said this bread. I want to put y'all in context of what's going on, right? Mm-hmm. Where was Mashiach when he spoke this? Huh? Can you hear me? You said Passover Pesach? Let me try to word it anyway. Okay, Passover Pesach. I ain't really talking about the land or anything. But where was he or who was he with? He was with Israel. He was with his disciples, right?
Yes.
And he was telling them about this feast and the importance of it and about eating the bread. This bread is the bread of life. Okay. Now, again, there are those who say, because we believe in Mashiach, and Mashiach is saying things such as eat my bread and drink my blood, right? They're saying that we're cannibal. Let's get this old leaven out of here right now. The Mashiach was with the disciples.
Yes.
And they were doing what? Eating and breaking bread because it said he broke the bread. So was he talking about eating his actual flesh? Okay, so we can get that old leaven out of there. For those that are poisoning many, oh, y'all cannibals, because the word said you're not supposed to eat flesh. You ain't supposed to eat people. That's against the dietary law. And see, that Jesus that y'all believe in got y'all talking about eating flesh and drinking blood. Use a little common sense for the nonsense. Okay? Little common sense for the nonsense. Purge, therefore, the old leaven. Get it out so that you can become a new lump. So with that being said, Mashiach was there and he broke actual bread. Y'all want me to parse it? Y'all want me to go to the Greek? Look, it's written. He actually broke literal bread. He did not actually say, y'all come here and take chunks out of my body and y'all look like zombies. He did not tell us to be cannibals.
No, he didn't.
It's a spiritual thing and it's an outward show. There's a word in Hebrew that's called oath, depending on the Hebrew dialect, or what, depending on Hebrew dialect, which means a sign. A sign is just simply me doing this. It's me doing it in remembrance of you, and it's representing you, but it's not you. It is actual, literal bread that we're supposed to eat. And I'm doing this in remembrance of you, and you say, while I'm doing this, I'm showing that I'm accepting you, and you say, if I do this, then I should have what? Eternal life, because I'm saying that I believe in the Mashiach, and I'm accepting him as that bread, as the bread of life, who was born or who lived in a place called Bethlehem, which is house of bread. He's the bread of life from the house of bread. Now, y'all check this out. I'm going to John chapter 14. just want y'all to remember, house of bread, bread of life, and that if we eat it, we should have eternal life. So now John chapter 14 and 15. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter that may abide with you forever. Even the Ruach, or the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither know of him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be
in you.
Where?
In you.
Bread of life, if you eat it, should be
in
you. Okay. This Torah is a scroll, and it's sweet to the taste, and you should do what? To the Torah? You should eat it, and you can find that written in the what? Old Testament. So I said, this is a sweet roll, it's sweet to the taste, but sometimes when you don't want to do some things that it says, it starts to get what to your taste?
Bitter.
And why does it get bitter to your taste? Because there's still some leaven somewhere sucking up the sugar.
That's right.
Anytime it starts getting a little sour to your taste, thou shalt not do that. Ain't what it's saying. No, it said, thou shalt not do that. But you've been doing it for 20-some years and you don't want to repent. So it's sour to your taste. But look, just make the changes. So again, it says, and it shall be where? In you. Even the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither know of him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet in a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and we will manifest ourselves by myself to him. And I'm going to fast forward, and it's going to come and say, we will make our abode where? In you and with you. So now if we're putting this word in us, then Mashiach and the Father's dwelling where? In us. So if I ask you right now, where's Mashiach?
In us.
What did Herod want to do? Y'all know the story, right? What did Herod want to do? Wanted to kill who? Let's be specific with this. Wanted to kill Mashiach.
Yes.
What does 11 brothers that want to teach against Mashiach want to do? Because when you start picking up this bread, you start putting this bread on life, which is the Torah and the testimony of Yahushua HaMashiach, which is a very important part of this meal that we're supposed to be partaking of. Once you understand the spiritual significance of what this meal is all about, you will see why I enjoy it so much now. And you should start enjoying it just as much as I, because it's about our Mashiach.
Yes.
And when someone is coming and trying to talk against Mashiach, they're trying to kill the Mashiach in you. I don't run to nobody else's assembly and congregations trying to bring them out. He said, those who the Father has sent to me. Why is it that we have those who like to go into others' houses to try to kill Mashiach that's in all of you? If you believe, some believe it, you do what you do. Believe the others alone. Put your teaching out there. If they come to you, hey, then they might not be the Father's. But if we're in here trying to keep Pesach, why would we want someone that want to try to talk away our Mashiach? Because it said, I am the bread of life. If you eat this bread, then I will be in you. If you keep the commandments, me and my Father will be in you. I am the bread of life, and you are Bethlehem. A Bethlehem. You are now the house of bread. And Herod sent out spies to try to spy out to find out where would this Mashiach be born. Going up there to Buford, Georgia on April 4th, 12:30, because the itinerary is out. I really don't believe it. I'm unworthy, but I'm going up in there to cause some confusion. I want to find out who's weak up in there so I can plant this non-Mashiach doctrine up in them. I want to kill the Mashiach that's in you. My brothers and sisters, I give this warning every Pesach. There will be those that will creep in unawares, and they're going to try to plant these seeds. They're going to try to plant a whole lot of leaven. Know ye this, a little leaven leavens the whole lump.
Yeah.
If Mashiach dwells with you and dwells in you, and you've been changing your life to serve the Father, understand the importance of the Passover meal. Understand that the Mashiach is our Savior. Passover is about salvation. The leavened bread is about sanctification. And after we're saved and sanctified, then we're what? We're resurrected. Because if you die in the Mashiach, during your immersion, then you what? You're supposed to arise in newness of life. So my Mishnah come. For 7 days, purge your house of unleavened bread and eat leavened sliga. Purge out leavened bread and eat matzah on unleavened bread for 7 days and eat the bread of life. And with that, I pray and hope everyone got some wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And I'm pretty good on my time, Moreh. I'm a little shorter than what was needed, but that's what I got for the day. My family, I hope y'all got some out of it. I pray you took my time.